we are going to be today discussing two very important sectors, if I may say so, or areas which impacts all of us. One is the real estate, and that has been severely impacted because of COVID, the pandemic, and the second, which I hope we all have access to, and if we don't, then we should and we must, and COVID has brought this home, is insurance. And joining me today is Sarabveer Singh. He's the CEO of Policy Bazaar, and Tanuj Shuri, he's the founder and CEO of Square Yards. Sarabveer, insurance, the more we talk about it, the better. And today, you know, how unfortunately pandemic has brought this close. I was speaking to Ashish Hemrajani yesterday, and he said that something he felt very personally good about, that everyone in his company had an insurance cover. And it just was, and it was so important that many of the people, and they had it not just for the employees, but their parents, and many of the parents fell sick. And they realized the value of the insurance coverage that they had for people. But tell us, from a sector, from a space perspective, are you seeing some kind of a accelerated momentum?
So, Shraddha, the short answer is yes. We are seeing massive accelerated momentum. And if you just look at it, insurance is something that we all know that we should have, but we all put off buying, right? Because you feel that mere ko nahi hoga, right? The whole point is ki kisi aur ke saath hoga, mere saath kabhi nahi hoga. That is, these are sort of low probability events. So हमको लगता है कि हमारे साथ नहीं होगा, किसी और के साथ होगा. So we say चलो बाद में देख लेंगे, right? Now this COVID, what COVID has done is that it's caused this, like I call it, like it's the mother of all sort of wake up calls, right? पूरी दुनिया में हो रहा है, अमिताभ बच्चन को भी हो रहा है, अमित शाह को भी हो रहा है. So now you can't say कि मेरे को नहीं होगा. So I think that whole thing, has obviously created a lot of anxiety. I think the whole lockdown, everything created a lot of anxiety in people. So, people understood why they should have insurance. A lot of people have, of course, come to buy insurance. And, of course, because Policy Bazaar is a digital, platform, they were able to buy from us, because traditionally they may have bought from agents or bank branch, which they couldn't do, especially in the beginning of COVID. So I think that way, I feel like COVID has done there's been a step change in first the awareness of why insurance is very important. And of course, some of those people have converted because, as you know, even if there is awareness, there isn't always conversion. So a lot of people still put it off.
Yeah.
It's definitely been and I think the insurance industry will never be the same. I think post-COVID, we will always have a higher awareness of the fact that things can happen to you. And it's, now, as you know, right, all of us know somebody or the other. I think we all know multiple
people.
So it's no longer your case.
I think the word which we use, the tectonic shift when it comes to insurance industry should happen now, right? Or should you? So you tell us, is it happening?
It's happening, Shraddha. It's happening. But, India is a large country. So there are always many factors at play. So one factor which is definitely helping is awareness of insurance has gone up. People have been coming, and especially, I would say, till June, July, right? There was huge demand that came up. But then there is another side to it also, right? Affordability is an issue. I mean, as we know, the salaried class has been hit by COVID.
Yeah.
Financial position has been hit. So some people are there who may want to buy but are still not being able to buy. So I think there are a variety of factors always at play in the country. But I do feel that, there is a change. Whether it will, finally as a percentage of GDP, those numbers will become still remain small. But I think it's going in the right direction. And I think for us as an industry, I think to that extent, it has been very positive. Like I said, people have understood why they should buy insurance. So I think that's a very important first step.
When you were saying this, Sarabveer, I was just thinking that maybe now people should gift insurance rather than, some flimsy thing that you gift, right? Like either for marriage or child birth or something.
That in Raksha Bandhan, but it was really hard. So we thought, because, Raksha Bandhan is all about protection.
Yeah.
So we said you should, protect your sister, right? Instead of giving some, chocolate or barfi or something, you can.
Yeah.
Pricing is not that different, right? You can give an installment for your sister for less than the price of, barfi or whatever the story is. But it's hard. I mean, to get people across the line. And to be fair, I think as an industry, we need to do better, right? We need to make the process simpler and easier and smoother so that people, find it easier to, let's say, give. It's definitely going in the right direction.
Yeah, Junal, I'll come back to you on what are some of the things that we could do to make it easy to get everyone. I have insurance because we need it. Tanuj, you know, did you get the question which I had asked in the beginning in terms of what are some of the things that you're seeing on ground when it comes to real estate segment? Because we are hearing that it is very severely hit. Many projects have stalled. But at the same time, I told you that I spoke to some very big real estate player, and he said that the home space is seeing a revival while commercial spaces have been hit. So what do you have to say? You're in the trenches. Okay. You will only have to talk. So, you know, I have to tell you something. I was speaking to the CEO of Nixi, Internet Exchange for India, which is like a government body. And they were saying that we have 750 million internet users in our country. I was like, wow. Like, you know, we keep all numbers, but this is an unprecedented number. How do you see digitalization helping insurance sector? And how can insurance sector get more and more people now onboarded because there is so many people connected?
Yeah, I think, Shraddha, whether the number is 750 million or 500 million or 200 million, one thing is very clear. Now there is enough people, right?
So, yeah.
There was a time when, we may have had a similar panel and, we could have had debate over whether 30 million, 20 million, right? So both. Yeah. Right now, it's very clear that there is no shortage of people on the internet, and all the appropriate people deserve to be congratulated for that. So, usme ab koi tension nahi. I think the issue and to answer your question again directly, what happened was that because there was no other option, right? Well, there's a saying, right? Necessity is the mother of invention or something like that. So I think that's what happened, right? So because there was no other way, you had to do everything digitally. And if I look at it from the regulator, right, from IRDA downwards, everybody has made it possible to do things in a digital manner. So now, soft copies of policies are completely accepted. Claims can be done in an online way. All the insurance companies, they realized that it was not just, to deal with the digital channel, but to deal with even their agents and with their, banking channels, they needed to be fully digital. And again, to be fair, they were already on this journey. So I think what happened is COVID has accelerated the change. So we were all trying to be digital, as for the last 10 years, everybody has only been talking about becoming more digital. So wo to ho hi raha tha, but the step change has come because of COVID, and everyone has become more accepting and more willing to experiment. Probably I've shared with you earlier that look at work from home, right? We as a company have always been talking about sending, having people work from home, but it was never going to happen. But suddenly in 10 days, we shifted, 70 to work from home, and touchwood, it's all working really well. So I think what COVID has done is accelerated the shift to digitization. Digitization was already happening. And again, that is a really positive thing because, as you said, consumers are already there. Consumers are happy now to consume digitally. And I think it will increase the pace of insurance penetration also, because people will find it easier to buy, easier to keep the policy, easier to use the policy. All those things are important from a consumer perspective. If I'm paying for something, I should be able to utilize it. And I think all of that is becoming much easier.
Yeah. One question I've always wanted to ask is that Policy Bazaar, of course, has done phenomenally well for many reasons, but one which we've also discussed, which you keep say with a lot of pride, is the insurance agents, like the insurance agents and the passion and the go-getters that they are. Are you seeing, and then India is largely relationship driven buying also when it comes to insurance. How do you see the change in the role of insurance agents in this new digital world?
So, Shraddha, that's obviously a very, very good question. I think what is happening is that now agents have more time, or advisors have more time to focus on relationship and understanding the needs of the consumer versus other administrative tasks. So what I mean by that, I'll give you an example. So if you look at our agents, right, when they talk to a consumer, the best agents are able to establish a rapport with the customer, right? What are their needs? Why are they looking for insurance? What is their, family context? They are able to establish that relationship, right? And now they have more time to do that versus worrying about aapki policy mili ki nahi, where is my soft copy, do I need to get a hard copy or not? What will I do when I have to make a claim? So all of those answers are becoming easier and easier. So in the ideal world, and I think that's where we are headed, whether it's offline agents or anybody else, over time, technology plus human beings are a more potent combination. So I feel that, you know, while we obsess a lot about this whole AI and you know, all these things that they are going to replace humans, but my bet is that I think they're going to make humans better
and effective,
more things and focus on the right issues versus, because as you must have seen, right, we have email, WhatsApp, whatever, 100 different devices, methods, but it's not like you are working less hours, right? Aisa to hai nahi ke,
yeah.
So we are still working for those 5, 6, 7 days, whatever we were working. So the point is that I think you're able to do other things. And I think that will be a very positive outcome because now agents will be able to focus on understanding the consumer and, you know, maybe helping them solve their problems versus focusing on administrative tasks, which technology I think is much better equipped to do and is slowly taking over. I think that's a very positive thing for them.
Basically, efficiency. You're saying it's bringing a lot more efficiency.
Also, it's allowing you to focus on the right thing, right? I mean, use of good time to focus on things which can be handled in a far more efficient and automated manner versus spending time on things that really matter to us, right?
So are you talking to your insurance agents? What are they saying? Are they experiencing this? Are they living this difference now?
So, you know, on our platform, Shraddha, the gap is not that much because we were always like that, right? At the end of the day, our whole point was that our advisors and agents only focus on, you know, the consumer need and, you know, understanding the need and driving that. The rest was always done by the platform, right? In fact, this is something that we always explain to consumers also, that you're getting the best of both worlds. You have a person whom you can talk to, but on the other hand, if there is any problem, there is a whole, you know, organization which is standing behind that person. It's not, you're not talking to one individual. So I think that part we have further enhanced, but I think it's a process, it's a journey.
It might
be more in offline where, you know, the agents earlier were doing everything manually. Now they might be able to do more things in a digitized manner.
Yeah. Yeah. Tanuj, now can you hear us? I hope you can. Okay. So I, Karabir, then I'll keep on asking you. So I want to see Policy Bazaar is today, you know, it is a market leader, and it covers of course it is a market leader. How are you seeing, and of course we are hoping that you will be the leader in terms of making changes when it comes to the way the product is offered and the way the product is delivered to the user. Are you thinking of making any kind of a change in the way insurance is delivered to us now?
Absolutely, Shraddha. So, you know, as you know, we've been on this journey, right, for ever since 2008. This has been the journey, right, to help the, to make the consumer get everything they can in the comfort of their own homes and, you know, be able to have access to it all the time. See, like I said, with insurance, there are two parts. One is buying the policy and the other is using the policy. And it's important that both parts are addressed, right, in a digital and convenient manner. So I think we have been on this journey. It was always going in that direction. But what this particular incident has helped us to do is that, you know, when you're having a conversation with the insurance company, they may be willing to say, okay, we'll do this now, this we'll do 6 months later, or maybe we'll do it next year or something like that, right? Because everybody has to prioritize their projects. Now, I think everybody is putting far more, priority on digitization. So I think for people like us, this is something that we have been discussing with our teams as well, that this is a great opportunity to get the things done, which we've always wanted to do. And, you know, let me give you an example so that it doesn't sound so theoretical. Like, you know, all medicals early in health insurance policies, you know, a medical exam is required. And they were mostly, you had to go to a doctor or to a center or something like that. Now, almost in 100% of the policies that you buy from us, a telemedical is done, where the doctor calls you, speaks to you, and, you know, asks you certain questions. And maybe in a very small proportion, a few percent of the people, they may have to actually go for a test. The reason this has been possible, see, the industry always knew that the efficacy of telemedical is as good as the efficacy of physical medical. So it was not that there is any efficiency issue, but just that, you know, what was being done in a certain way kept getting done. Now, because there was a change, you know, people have adopted this. And I think now this is being adopted as a change. And I don't think we'll go back. I don't think now we'll go back to, you know, physical medical. So I think these are the kind of technology changes. And, you know, this makes the whole process far simpler. And so that when you feel that mujhe health insurance lena chahiye, you will be able to get it right away. So that there's no friction and it won't break.
This is a huge step. This is a very, very significant step.
And it's good for both sides. It's
yeah.
insurer, it saves cost for everybody, and it's more convenient. And you're also doing the medical, right? So
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Finally.
Loud and clear.
It's so embarrassing. So sorry. It never happens like this. But so sorry, Sabir, also.
No. Tanuj, I was saying that you are getting the jitters like the real estate segment. Tell us. What are you seeing?
Yeah, I heard your question loud and clear thrice. So I think it's been a tale of two halves. Like immediately after the COVID, obviously everyone went to the toss. The market collapsed and the sector as in itself collapsed. So predominantly there were end use buyers in India before that. Like 99% of the transactions were the end use buyer. India was not an investor market for real estate. What that changed immediately after the COVID. So end users were willing to wait 3 months, 6 months. They were not willing to buy before going and visiting the site, before going to see the project which they had. But what that did was also created enough opportunities for the investor segment, which had not come in Indian real estate for a fairly significant time. So people who had been sitting on fences, people who had not been making a decision for the last 12 months, 15 months, they thought that if during COVID, we cannot get deal of our lifetime, probably we will never get. Like if we were waiting for prices to come down, prices probably would not go down lower than what they can during the COVID time. So we saw a sizable traction amongst the investor audience. We saw a sizable traction amongst the people who had been sitting on fences. But like every other sector, there was a flight to safety. So the larger guys won. The larger principals who people trusted would build, would deliver stronger balance sheets, won a small market share of a very, very small pie, which remained after the COVID. So the winners were the larger guys. The losers were the smaller guys. And I think in some sense, if we see retrospectively, all these investors and all these people who had sitting on fence for residential, I'm talking about, were partly vindicated. So last 3 months has seen a month after month sizable improvement, which has surprised everyone, including us. Even I would not have anticipated, and we would have said that probably it will take 6 months or 9 months for volumes to come back, or probably a year for volumes to come back. This quarter has rebounded very, very strongly, and more than the quarter, last 2 months have seen a very significant traction. New projects being launched, sold out in 2 weeks. New projects launched, sold out in a week, which used to happen pre-COVID days in certain markets like Pune, but no one could imagine that happening during the COVID time. So that was on residential. So we are on a path to recovery. My sense is by next quarter, we would be at the pre-COVID volumes. On the commercial real estate though, like you had mentioned briefly, the impact is much larger. Obviously, with the changing work from home policies, the demand for commercial and demand for grade A larger commercial has definitely gone down. And I think that would be a fairly midterm impact. I don't know long term how consumer behavior would change or would not change, but that could definitely deteriorate for the next couple of years, if not more.
Oh, that's very significant, right? That's right. Yeah. And of course, I think it's also been triggered because we are all looking at different geographies and players like Google, Facebook, they have all shut offices for April, May, or I don't know, till the vaccines come back.
So not just that. So there were corporates who were expanding. Even if they are expanding now, they are not looking for the larger office spaces because they still don't know what percentage of their people would work from home, what percentage of people would come to offices. Someone like us who is expanding and who needs office space, we can't survive work from home nature of our industry. Even us, we are very, very strongly renegotiating the terms. And we are getting the terms which we had not imagined we might get pre-COVID days. So from that perspective, then that's clearly visible. There is a significant pressure on the demand side, which is ensuring that, and a lot of supply. And what had happened that commercial in India was one of the more under-penetrated sectors. So there was a lot of supply which was launched over the last 24 to 36 months, grade A supply, which is either coming for delivery now or will come over the next 12 months. So you will suddenly see a situation where there is year on year increase in supply, but year on year significant decrease in demand.
That's very sad. That's very, very. In fact, Sarabveer, my conversation with Mr. Daya was that you know, people who work the call center employees, now you don't have an office, right? Like now they're working from home.
Yeah. No, I think what Tanuj just said is a reality for us. I mean, we have a lot of office space and reducing that footprint. And I think we'll probably end up reducing it even more, because I think one of the learnings for us is that perhaps there is a portion of our workforce which doesn't need to come to office, you know, every day. And so we don't need as much space as we had. And, you know, I'll tell you an interesting story on this, Shraddha. We have started a program which is called Ghar Vapsi. So what that program really means is that we, you know, over the last 2 years, we calculated that we had over 2,000 women employees who had left Policy Bazaar, not for performance reasons, but because they had, you know, they got married or they had to move out with their family, you know, their husband got transferred or something like that. So what we did was that we have reached out to those 2,000 and said that, look, if you would like to come back and work with us, because we know your performance, we know that you're a good employee and, you know, you have a good earnings opportunity, you can join from anywhere, wherever you are.
Yeah.
Right now, you're not. And I'm, you know, happy to report that I think over 400 people, 400 women have joined.
So wow, that's a very good thing. Super. Yeah.
Good thing for both sides, right? They are getting employment, they're getting some, they're able to do what they're good at. And for us, you know, we are getting really motivated and talented employees who we would not have been able to keep. So I think the whole way of thinking about office space is going to change. Now, I think it's still an open question. How much will it change, right? I mean, is it that we will never, you know, need offices ever again? But I definitely think for the foreseeable future, there is going to be a hybrid model. I think the, you know, the days of expanding by adding office space probably will go down, at least in some way.
And I'm sure that is not just about the vaccine or the impact of the corona. I think what organizations, and Satbeer could agree with me, I think so, that organizations have started realizing, which probably they didn't realize before, that they could have a decent amount of productivity without having a certain section of their people in office. So they would save that corporate cost of office expenses.
You know, when you were saying this, I remember talking to the Mr. Rajneesh Kumar from SBI, and he was saying SBI is rethinking. Now SBI is saying that
SBI, and, you know, can rethink, anyone can.
No, because they come what may, they have such structured processes, and now they are saying that you know, work from home can be like and should be a norm for a lot of their employees. But anyways, Tanuj, coming back to you, what, you know, you, and then you talk to so many real estate builders. What is the sentiment right now? Like, of course, we know that what's happening in both the spaces, but what is the sentiment?
So a fair way to put that is sentiment is improving. Having said that, the last 6 months have been very, very challenging, soul crushing, however the right word we use, for a lot of developers. So not everyone had the balance sheet to sustain almost zero sales. Everyone, and it's not just the sales, it's coupled with the fact that a lot of consumers who had bought the under construction homes, they delayed payments because of COVID. So it was an impact. Probably the larger guys were able to still live with it and live for another day, that we will come back stronger once the market improves. But a lot of smaller guys are struggling and seriously struggling. And that could have a ripple effect on the entire economy per se, because you're talking about NBFCs who had lent significant amount of money to these smaller developers. So if something blows up there, that goes back to the bad loan book of NBFCs, that flows up to the economy per se. Having said that, the sentiment is improving. But again, Shraddha, the sentiment is only improving, and the sales are only improving against that amongst the 20% of the principals, the larger grade A developers. The smaller guys still continue to struggle.
Yeah, you know, because Tanuj, the space that you are in, it contributes so much to our economy and GDP. And, you know, and we're saying that next fiscal, we will go back to 8.8. Our GDP will go back to such numbers. So the real estate space has to, drive that, right?
So government needs to figure out ways to somehow increase the demand. And I don't know if you recollect, long back we were discussing on this forum that government should come in, regulator should come in and probably slash indirect cost. So Maharashtra took that step slashing stamp duty. That definitely had an impact. So things like that need to happen. You can't go to 9% GDP with real estate struggling. You can't, just not.
Yeah. We all will be packed it. So if you have to say 2-3 things that we need to do to, you know, and if you had to say, like, you know, to the government or, you know, just to us as a country, what are the 2-3 things that we should do on an immediate term basis?
First and foremost, focus has to come on demand. Now, obviously, the economy, job recreation, salary growth, all that will take their own sweet time. But there are significant steps governments can take to slash. Like in real estate, almost 30% of the cost is indirect, which consumer can avoid paying. Effectively it's like refueling the economy. Effectively, the spend you have fiscal reserves and you use from that. Like for example, stamp duties, land prices, so multiple other things basically which intensify the demand. A, B, RERA was a step in right direction. Obviously, RERA has not achieved its full potential. That is probably 40% where it should be. So a lot of effort and focus has to come in there. Like what we were discussing earlier, that the larger guys won because A, they had the balance sheet, B, they were more structured. The problem is in India is that larger guy bracket is only sub 10% or sub 15% of the overall pie. That has to go to 50% of the overall pie. And for that significant new regulations need to come in much sooner than probably what were anticipated before. The industry has to get structured much faster. Probably what happened to insurance, what happened to equities over the last couple of decades, real estate cannot afford to take 2 decades to go through that cycle. It has to be probably shortened within the next couple of years or within a year. So you take care of the unorganized space, you take care of the demand, I think a lot of things will fall into and then obviously rest everything is linked to the economy and salaries obviously.
Yeah, you know, demand is the biggest biggest issue right now. That where will the demand come from? But anyways, if you know, and then to both of you, I would like to ask is that how do you see? And we are talking today at Tech Sparks. How do you envisage or how do you believe or you know think that technology can help in, and it doesn't have to be necessarily in your sector, but how can technology play a very crucial role in accelerating growth in our country, in our economy? And I know it's a very large macro question, but I think it's an important question because we are all going to be affected if all the sectors don't grow right now.
So huge role. I'll let Satveer answer because it has had significant impact on insurance space per se, and direct, much more direct impact, and they had been one of the beneficiaries. But I think technology is not just building apps or making user journey more efficient. I think it's effectively trying to bring the entire ecosystem which can do the job much faster, much more in a much more scalable way. Like for example, when it comes to the real estate, apart from the few direct interventions the technology can have, is like digitized transaction module, registration should go online. I'm not touching there. They are a given. I think they are the basics which we need to evolve to. But like for example, the concept of smart economy, smart cities. Now India, for India to even think of becoming a China. Over the next 10 decades, next 2 decades, India needs to have 100 smart cities. And you can't, India cannot work with 5 metros. India has been working with 5 metros. That's the problem. And it's all interlinked. Why India is working with 5 metros? Because infrastructure is non-existing in the other cities. The supply, the economy, the job creation, everything is interlinked. And for that, we need to step out of those boundaries. And we have had success stories globally. Not just China, there have been other emerging economies which had been able to create multiple smart cities, multiple larger cities rather. Smart is the wrong word. And for that, tech has to play a sizable role there to be able to do that. I'll let Satveer answer, but insurance definitely has had a significant disruption from technology.
Yeah.
Thanks. I think you made a very important point that, you know, we should not look at technology in a narrow lens as being consumer journey or apps or stuff like that. You know, what we internally, we use the word smart technology. And I think one of the things that, like for instance, I'll give an example, what we have done is that using the data and information that we have about our consumers, we are able to help insurance companies offer them better prices, right? So you know, you are a certain type of person. We know more about you than others. How do you browse? What other policies have you bought? So various other metrics that we know about you. That allows us to, you know, help our insurance partners give better prices to you as a person. Now that is far more important technology than just, you know, saying that, okay. And again, I'm not sort of saying that the user journey and apps are not important. Those are also super important. But sometimes changing the core structure is more important than just the what you see on the surface. So technology is playing a big role in insurance. And I think it will, to Shraddha's question, I think it will play a huge role in changing the economy. Because one of the things that allows, you know, India is a country to think about it. We have a lot of people who don't earn a lot of money, right?
Yeah.
So change this thing. It is going to be, you know, and there are, I'm sure, you know, public policy experts have many solutions for this. But one thing I personally believe is that technology allows is a force multiplier for every person. So like if we spoke about, you know, insurance agent, for example, I think technology will allow that insurance agent to serve far more customers than he or she could have done without it. So I think that is the kind of stuff that this country needs. We need to improve the efficiency, productivity of our people. Because if you see in every sort of sphere, our productivity always comes out to be lower, right? And the productivity, technology is the only sort of one of the main roles it can play. So I do think technology will play a huge role. And honestly speaking, if you ask me, can you imagine if we had COVID without the kind of broadband and connectivity that we have today, right? COVID had happened in India, I promise you that the impact of COVID would have been massive.
Right? Yeah.
The fact that we could manage is a function of, you know, this hard work that people have done to allow connectivity, to allow all these, you know, almost free experiences that we have. I mean, I think if there was no WhatsApp, I think there would be many companies in India which would not be able to function. So, I think this is the real power of technology, and I think it has helped a lot. Otherwise, you know, I feel that things would have been far worse. I'm sure that developed countries may have actually done better because they always had some form of, you know, connectivity and things going there, whereas we didn't. And I think you can just see that difference. So I think technology is a really powerful enabler, and I think we are headed in the right direction. I mean, if you see, I think even the government, I think, recognizes that, and they're continuously trying to go in the right direction. Hopefully, the pace of change will become faster.
True. You know, Sarapi, there's this question suddenly has got my attention is that where is the insurance market going vis-a-vis mental health coverage?
I wanted to answer that, Shraddha. I also saw it. It's a very important question. Later, from 1st October 2020, all policies will cover mental health.
Yay.
Nice.
This is covered. So, I did want to address that point because it's an important point.
Oh, this is a huge point. So this 1st October.
Yes. So from earlier this month, all policies that you buy cover mental health.
Wow. This is first time, right?
Yes. This is a very forward-looking and I think very important step. It's something to recognize that mental illness is as much an illness as any physical illness.
Yeah.
And this is happening across providers, Sarbir?
Yes. It's any health policy that you have now from after 1st October has to cover mental health.
Super.
Wow, this is very, very significant. And we first heard it here at TechSpark. So we should really promote it because it's very important. Very, very big thing. Yeah.
It's a huge step because it you know, transforms the way we all look at it. I think all of us, at least I speak for myself, I think it's very important to appreciate that mental health is as much an illness as any other. And these kind of steps, you know, make a big difference to the whole thing. Treatment, you know, treatment does help. So I hope people... More people will become aware of it.
And it is also a significant cost, right? Like, especially for some of the mental health issues, which are not going away anytime soon. Yeah.
Sure. I mean, again, it's something that is a very positive and I think powerful.
Huge thing. I'm very happy to hear this. You know, my brother has schizophrenia, but this is very, very important, you know, because they're just not recognized in any way. This is huge. Right. Now, I want to ask both you, Sarabir, and Tanuj, and Sarabir, you know, how long now that you've been the CEO at Policy Bazaar?
11 months.
You know, I have huge respect for you, and you, you know, I believe that you are one of the finest thinkers, doers in our country. and also not and not a talker, much of a talker. So it's always very good because you talk very candidly. You know, tell me as a CEO, what has been your, I really want to understand, has there been any learning in your journey because you observed so many things? Have you seen any change in yourself or in the way you conduct yourself, which all of us, everyone watching today, can pick up or at least reflect on? And Tanuj, then I'd love to hear from you on the topic.
I think, Shraddha, one of the things that we've all learned in the last, I would say, 6-7 months especially, is that how you motivate employees and motivate your team has changed, right? And I would guess that must be the same for Tanuj also. See, earlier in the physical world, there was an element of you could, you know, what I call, you could, you know, force your personality on somebody, right? And you could say, ki bhai, main keh raha hun toh aise hi hoga, right? Now, what has changed is that I think, And this is something again a journey, right? That people want to have purpose. And we've always spoken about it. And many times one felt like, yeah, this is a warm, fuzzy concept, which is not really glory. But I think now what has happened is that it has become very true. Because like when somebody, see, after all our employees were in the same boat as the consumer. Right? They were also worried about their health. They were trying to figure out, ki humko kahan rehna hai? Should we go back to where we, you know, to our hometown? Should we stay here? There were a lot of decisions they were taking. So now at that stage, you had to be very, very clear as to why you are asking them to do something.
Yeah.
What reason that they should do it? What will be the intended outcome of it? And how you have to cut out, one of the important things is to cut out the, you know, non-essential stuff. So one thing that I learned is that, you know, as a leader, sometimes, you know, one has many plans, right? We should do this also, we should do that also. This would also be good to do. You know, I saw some feature on some other site. We should also implement it, right? What you realize is that you can't do it like that. You have to strip the problem down to very core essentials. What are we trying to do? Like in our case, we are trying to help consumers deal with death, disability, and disease. So we only focus on those things. And the nice to do things, they can wait for a while because right now people have other things to do, right? So I think this whole model of leadership has to change from being sort of a prescriptive to actually taking a step back, explaining why you should do things and helping people understand the path. Rather than driving them towards it. Because as you know, if you yell at somebody on video, right? You know, video kharab ho jata hai, right? I think this is a very important learning for me also, that how to, and it's hard to do, right? Because it's easy to say that,
yes,
motivate people by giving them purpose and all that. But we have to get the work done also, right? So you have a challenge on both sides. But I do believe that this is a very important and, you know, valuable lesson that I have learned, and I'm sure all of us are learning, that how, you know, to keep people motivated on the right path and yet appreciate their problems, right? See, one of the things that I also believe is that one has to listen to the other side. Somebody may say that I can't do this by this date, but I'll do it by, you know, in 5 days later because of this ABCD reason. And honestly, you have to judge and in some cases say that's fine, and obviously in some cases push back. So I do think it has made us all probably a bit more logical and understanding
leaders. Yeah, yeah, but a very important point that the why has to be clear. You can't be prescriptive, no more. Like, then force your personality. Why? Tanuj? So,
I think pretty much everything what Sarvjit said, motivation is the holy grail. Let me try and add something new. I don't know, it's very specific to us or it's relevant for it, or other leaders found it relevant during the last few months. I think one thing we started questioning ourselves was, and we eventually were proved wrong, is whether we should put ourselves in consumer shoes. And age-old debate, right? Steve Jobs used to say that, let me build products which I want because consumers don't know what they want, versus you always work according to what consumer wants. And now I think during COVID, especially in the first 2 months, what we realized, if we had gone by the perception of what consumer might want, we would have struggled. The reason for us doing what we did in 3 months of COVID in the market share and everything was one fine day. And we were heading in that direction. So I'll tell you, the 2 weeks before pre-COVID, internally, we were almost ready to shut down for 3 months. Like, we had made oral arrangements, like how we're going to not layoffs, but we're going to go into the slumber mode and wake up after 3 months when the industry wakes up. It just happened one fine day. I woke up on the right side of the bed and I suddenly questioned myself, yaar, we need to control we need to control the controllables, and we can't let other situations dictate where we are heading to. So we told ourselves, even as someone like me who has a very high risk appetite, even I won't buy a real estate during COVID, even though I have a very, very high risk appetite. So why would people buy? I question myself. No, India is the beauty of India is a billion consumers. Every consumer has a different risk appetite. Sitting here in my room, based on how my perception or my management team's perception or reaction to a particular situation of a crisis cannot define how those consumers will behave. Our job is to play the game of probability, build the best product, build the best distribution, and then let probability of the masses win it for us. And that's what we did. So we worked on few product structurings. We brought in some product structurings which did not exist in the market before, and which made a risk reward much more profitable for a lot of people who were sitting on the fence. And April was the best ever month in our history. So that significantly resonated with us and continues to resonate with us, that now we don't do anything based on how we will react as management team or my people around me in a certain situation. We let consumers react the way they should and can react, and then you just work on the probability.
Yeah. And then to both of you, again, if you can talk about this, and sort of we from Policy Bazaar's perspective and Tanuj from Square Gads, because this way, you know, if you could give your, if there is an example you could share, is that in terms of productivity, and I'm talking because you're leaders of the organization, somewhere has COVID brought a different lens to how we look at productivity? How do we look at engagement with the team, in engagement in the way we look at our culture? Because these are very significant questions in a environment where more or less we are having a hybrid blended kind of work environment, and this is going to stay. This is not going to change anytime soon. And because what I have been hearing from people is that you know, now they are more productive. There's more productivity now. So I just want to understand what has changed in Policy Bazaar, or what are some of the new things that you're doing in Policy Bazaar, and what are you doing in Square Yards? Yeah.
So I think, Shraddha, what I would say from our experience is that, yes, initially, and even I would say it's true today, that we feel we are more productive than we used to be. And I think initially the reason simply was that initially there was a lot of fear and anxiety amongst everybody. I think there was, in our team, there was this belief that we must do our best, because right now, you know, we don't want to be part of companies where, you know, there are job losses or, you know, job pay cuts or whatever. I think there was an element of that very natural, you know, instinct to say that let's all work very hard. Also, we were all stuck at home, right? There's nothing, we couldn't go anywhere, you were scared, everything. So I think initially, definitely, I would say the people put in a lot of hours, and, you know, there was a lot of, like, effort put in. Over time, obviously, that has normalized a bit. I think people are now doing other things also. So things are normalized. But I do think that one thing that and for me, it was really interesting to see, is that it was a window on what your culture really is. Because, see, culture is something that we all talk about, and, you know, you can always say that many times, you know, people say that this is the culture I want, right? But whether you have it or not, you don't know, right? It's easy to, again, talk about it. And in this moment, when there was a crisis, when people had to work without necessarily direct supervision, et cetera, I think we all learned about our teams, about where the culture was strong, where people, you know, what was the culture, right? Was it a working hard, or was it, you know, doing other things? So I think it was a very good window, at least for me personally, to see what actually our culture is. Now, I think we've learned about that, and I think we are also now trying to say that, okay, which direction we want to go. And that is admittedly a bit harder. At least I personally find it harder to communicate with people when you're not able to meet them at all face-to-face. So as you know, we have started coming to office a little bit, at least those people who can come. And I think that has helped us to, you know, build sort of equations and relationships again. So I do think that over a period of time, we realize that human beings are social in nature, and we do need to meet each other. Maybe we don't need to meet each other every day, but I think managing community without meeting will also be a hard thing. I think something there, and you know, so far, Tashu, we have not had a problem with productivity at all. And I put it actually down to our culture. I think it's the fact that people had internal motivation and drive, and I think our team leaders also were able to manage that. And I think I give them all a lot of credit
I think it touched, sorry, it's also, sorry, I'm just bringing this point out because what you said, and I'm just reiterating for myself and for everyone, is that also, this also happened when you said culture is somewhere to the last answer that you gave, right? Like the why must have been very clear.
Absolutely, I think it is, yeah. The why is people believe in the why. And of course, we've also discovered, you know, there are pockets where perhaps the why was not as clear. And I think now we need to make sure that everyone understands that.
Yeah. Tanuj.
So this is one answer. So I think it again boils down to the culture in a different way, that rallying together towards a particular goal. We realized internally that these few months are probably one off window we will get, and it might not get repeated to get ahead of the pack, to win a much larger amount of market share, to stamp mind share vis-a-vis anyone else who probably may not be that aggressive in our space. And we use that. We use that across the board, across organization, across employees, and drove them for a sizable amount of time towards that one goal, that these 3 months we have to get much ahead of the pack, to create that daylight distance. And everyone worked towards that. Having said that, probably, so that's a larger answer. But the productivity went up sharply, partly because of that, but partly because of very, very small things. Like, for example, internally, the organization process-wise, what we had been trying to create was digitized organization. But what was being created on ground was a significant offline organization. Like all these ERPs and everything was good to have, but people really didn't follow it hand on the heart. What COVID did was force them to do it. So the organization became digitized. What was expected to have happened much before happened during those times, and that really helped the productivity in terms of how you track the sales team, how you track productivity, how you track meetings, how you track everything. And that really helped in terms of the small inputs, but the larger emphasis is very, 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 very similar to what Sarbvir said, that working much harder than we had ever done before, working towards a particular purpose, which existed in a larger frame of time, but this was a short span of time that we need to do it in 4 months, not 4 years.
And Tanuj, I have to ask you one very quick question. You know, you are in a segment which was like massively impacted. Matlab, offline and how? Real estate and how? Were there insecure nights and stressful moments? Or you were like, nahin, nahin,
like I said, a week before COVID, before lockdown, not before COVID. So that last 10 days of March, yes. But once we rallied ourselves that yaar, we need to change what is happening around us, uske baad, there was a one-way street.
I like, want to understand that mental process, wo jo 10 din mein stress or fatigue kaise hoga. Matlab, because
and trust me, that was so stressful. We were running helter-skelter, figuring out amongst ourselves, how's everything going to go? How are we going to pay? How are we going to get revenue? Will there be any revenue or will there be zero revenue? And how are we going to drive the old relationships? How are we going to retain the old consumers? Every small thing. And honestly, Shraddha, why we moved so quickly in those 10 days was a result of there was such a significant stress that it came to a point where we told ourselves ki if we don't go in a hyper-aggressive mode, we will not be able to survive. So the only way out, sometimes the only way out is only way to survive is to fight back, counter attack. And that's what we did. And luckily that worked.
Yeah. That Intel founder said, no, if only paranoid survive. Yeah. Okay. What a good discussion we've had. Thank you. This has been such a meaningful discussion, and I hope I'm not leaving any important question. How has consumer buying changed for insurance products? Sarabveer said that they are buying more online now. You said, Sarabveer, on the leadership lessons, do you think remote working will become a norm for many companies? Now that's an answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. What do you have to say? Will it be a norm, working from home?
I don't think it will become a norm in a long run. But again, who knows what happens. But my sense is humans are social animals. That's one. And two, I think we do have, humans have a tendency to jump to extremes in everything. So the future will never be one extreme or the another extreme. I think we will find a way to get a balance. A, and people significantly underestimate resilience. I'm in Dubai, so I'm based in Dubai. And if you are in Dubai, it's practically life pre-COVID. Gyms are open, schools are open, movies are open. Yes, people are wearing masks, people are taking precautions, but it is everyone, our office is 100% capacity, we are hiring. So it's everything life of Jan or Feb. And so as and when the country is recovered, the fatigue sets in, people will figure out a way to live with it.
Yeah. Tarabhi?
Yeah, in general, I agree with Anuj in the sense that we overextend. What happens is that whatever little has happened in the short term, we overextend it, right? We believe that this is now the future. So I'm not one to say that everyone will be working from home, but I do think that some things that were not imaginable have been made possible. So I do think that change will be there. And some of us will hopefully learn the right lessons that you don't have to take a flight for every small meeting. you take a flight when it's required, but maybe we can manage more with, distance and everything. So I think there will be some changes. But are we never going to have offices again? I don't think that's likely. There are reasons why offices were made to begin with. And some of those reasons are good. There were some bad reasons.
Yeah. Thank you. We can continue having this conversation because this was so real, informative, and two sectors, insurance, Policy Bazaar, Saravir Singh. And we hope to continue talking to you because, I want to have another conversation with you on just mental health coverage and how it has become part of insurance coverage because it's a significant step. And thank you, Saravir, for always being so real. Thank you. And Tanuj, thank you. When I was seeing that black and white, I was thinking, which part of the world? Is it Delhi ka design lag raha hai ya kahin aur ka? Definitely not Bangalore, but you are in Dubai. And hats off to you, the way, because we all are today in it, but we understand what it would mean for the real estate sector and how with Square Yards you are really changing the way real estate, prop tech. Prop tech space is surviving and hopefully thriving. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Radha. Thanks, Arvind.